So hopefully it would work.
Okay, recording, great.
Great. So maybe I should do that again. Okay, well, welcome everybody to this week's seminar in the non-commutative geometry and topology in Prague. The speaker this week is Bert Flower, who's coming from Harry White University in Edinburgh, and the title is Universal K-Matrices for Quantum Groups of Katzmann D-Type. So please, Bert.
Thank you very much, Raymond, for the invitation, for the introduction, and thanks everybody for your interest. And so this is a topic I've been working on together with Andrea Appel, who's now at the University of Parma, who was at the University of Edinburgh before. So it was kind of a joint Edinburgh project about universal K-matrices. And so I will explain all the words in the title, hopefully, and give some motivation and explain our construction and then the concepts behind it. Okay, so please feel free to interrupt me with any questions. It's a fairly small group, so I feel like we should be able to be kind of informal, and so just interrupt if there's any questions. Okay, so this is the plan. So I'll give you kind of a motivation, some overview, some kind of recent history of progress in this direction, and kind of the main goals we want to achieve with this project. And then section two will be some nitty-gritty detail about the quantum groups I'm interested in. It's a fairly short section though. Then section three will be some conceptual section where we outline the ideas, the generalizations of the concept. And that allows us to, in section four, find a generalization of a particular construction of a solution of a set of equations, basically. Okay. So I want to start with some sure-while duality-inspired motivation for quantum groups. So let me first say briefly recall the notion of a quantum group, and for this I need to give you the definition of quasi-triangularity, which is kind of a big block of a definition here, but it's actually fairly very natural definition. So we all know and love co-commutative bialgebras, or perhaps you prefer the dual picture, and then it's you have to think about commutative bialgebras. And then there's a natural generalization. So I'm working with the co-commutative bialgebras, and I want to modify this into something that's not quite co-commutative. And then the key idea is that instead of asking it to be co-commutative, you ask it to be co-commutative up to conjugation by some element. So conjugation I always denote by at. So whenever you see at, it just means conjugation by, kind of inspired by Lie theory. So if you do this, so if you have a bialgebra with a co-product and you request that there exists an element that satisfies this condition, then this has to be a very special element. This can't be any old element you have lying around. It needs to satisfy, it needs to be compatible with the co-product itself. It follows from the co-associativity axioms. So, and then the nicest way for that to be true is if axiom two is also satisfied. So two properties of the co-product of this R matrix. Okay, and then there's this notation with subscripts that tells you basically how this element is embedded into a triple tensor product. You have a natural way to denote this. Okay, so that's the definition. So why do we care about this? So well, the main thing is the last point here is that the category of modules of such a bialgebra is naturally braided by a collection of elements. So you simply take this R matrix and you apply the representation map associated to two modules of this bialgebra, and then you simply compose with the very simple map PVW, which is just a linear map and just flips elements element-wise. Okay, because this is on the level of elements. This is the simplest map you could have. And if your bialgebra was co-commutative, then this R matrix would be trivial, would be one tensor one, and you would just have this P. So basically you're replacing this kind of naive flip PVW by a more sophisticated flip, which is the composition with this image of the universal R matrix R. So this R is called universal R matrix. I should perhaps say this as well. Okay, so the second point is that the R matrix itself satisfies some kind of braid relation, or something that is easily modified into a braid relation. So the object that's here at the, in the third point actually satisfies a genuine, you know, cubic type A braid relation. And so you have an action of the braid group, standard Artin braid group on mod H. And finally, there's the first point I mentioned, the last is simply, let's say that there's a natural way to construct another quasi-triangular bialgebra from an existing one by simply flipping everything around in terms of tensor products. So the co-product becomes the opposite co-product and R becomes R21. It's really, I only say this really to introduce this notation, which is something we'll see coming back through throughout the talk. So this is the co-opposite bialgebra. Okay? So what can you do now? Well, you would like to have examples of this, which are interesting in some sense. So what you can do is you can construct, let's say, a certain low-dimensional example. And Sweetler did this in the late 60s. He really wanted to have an example of a bialgebra which is not commutative and not co-commutative. And he just made it in terms of generators and relations. But this particular bialgebra doesn't have a very interesting, well, from my point of view, a very interesting class of modules. There's simply four indecomposable modules, and you can take tensor products of those. Well, okay, it's a kind of a nice toy example, but it's a bit limited. And it also, another thing, it doesn't really degenerate into a co-commutative algebra in any meaningful sense. So what we really want is a quantum group. And a quantum group, this is my unofficial definition, it's a quasi-triangular bialgebra which depends on the parameter. And if you send the parameter to a special value, let's say one, then you recover a co-commutative bialgebra. Okay? So this is unofficial because I haven't specified what I mean by sending a parameter to one. And I won't specify this, but there's a large class of examples where you would say it meets this definition. So let's call it a quantum group. So there's also, of course, the dual notion where you would have a non-commutative object that degenerates into a commutative object. That's, of course, you could call it a quantum group as well. So it's not by any means just an exhaustive definition. It's just a rough guide. Okay. And then this is the kind of an important way of constructing interesting examples. So quantum groups being interesting examples of quasi-triangular bialgebra. So you simply start with a Lie algebra over the, let's say, the complex number, simple Lie algebra, and the universal enveloping algebra is canonically a co-commutative bialgebra. This is the co-product given in terms of elements of G, and then extended multiplicatively. And then you can deform this. So Drinfeld and Jimbo in the 80s found a way to deform this. And it's simply very simple. The generators of the universal enveloping algebra are simply preserved, except that this HI, this Cartan element, which is a part of a commutative subalgebra, is replaced by some invertible group-like element TI. Okay, and then the relations, I haven't specified them here, but the relations are also deformed in some sense. And what I did give you is the explicit formulas for the coproduct, at least one convention for the formulas for the coproduct. And you, at least you can clearly see that it's not symmetric, so it's not co-commutative. Now, this is quasi-triangular. There's a technicality here, which is kind of part and parcel of the quantum group story, is that it's quasi-triangular up to completion. And it is always a little bit technical to explain what this means precisely, but for our purposes, it's enough to say that the R matrix, which should really be in the tensor product of UQG with itself, actually lies in an extension or a completion of the tensor product. UQG, tensor UQG. So that is where you would like it to be, but it's actually in this larger algebra. And the only thing that this really, it's not really a big problem. The only thing that you have to keep in mind is now that it means that certain representations of UQG won't be good anymore. So this R can only be evaluated in particular representations. And that's simply the ones that where it works. So the category of representations of UQG, so the category of UQG models, which is braided with this R matrix, is actually a class of finite dimensional modules where, let's say, this TI acts like Q to the HI, roughly speaking. So it's precisely the modules that you would be interested in. Okay. Now, so you might say, well, why don't we then call the completion of UQG the quasi-triangular bialgebra. Why do we have to say up to completion? So this is the point is you can define a completion of UQG, which is called UQG1 of this one copy of the quantum group, but then this twofold completion is actually properly contains the tensor product of this one-fold completion. So it won't even be good enough to simply work with UQG1. This R matrix really requires kind of a bit more complicated expressions, if you like. You really have to essentially work with the completion. You can't just work with a larger algebra from the start. But this is kind of a technicality, but it doesn't really matter in terms of the power of the theory. You just have to restrict to a particular nice category of modules. That's the only constraint. Okay, so what can you do? So one thing you can do with simple algebras is you can look at representations on tensor products, since we have co-products. So ensure wild duality, which is kind of one thing I want to use to motivate the goal I'm setting myself today, is a statement about not quite a simple Lie algebra, but let's say GLN and the symmetric group. There's a relation between these two groups. Let's say it's the general linear group and the symmetric group. So they both act naturally on tensor products. So the symmetric group acts by swapping factors in the tensor product in a natural way. And GLN, let's say, let me work with the algebra. GLN acts by the coproduct. That means it acts in its standard way on CM, on the first CM, and then it also acts on the other CM. And you simply add up all these actions together, and that's precisely what the coproduct does for you. And that's, so this is what I call pi n here, simply the natural extension of the vector representation of G to this n-fold tensor product. And simply here, rho is simply the map that encodes the standard action of the symmetric group on tensor products. Okay, so this is simply standard Schuwald duality, but written in terms of algebras rather than groups. And then the point is, so this is really, I haven't actually said what Schuwald duality means, but it simply means that the actions of these two algebras have images in the endomorphism algebra of this n-fold tensor product, and these images are each other's centralizer. So they commute with each other, and they are precisely the subalgebras that commute with each other in both directions. And so it's a very nice setup, and then this can be used to a very kind of nice combinatorial formulas for decompositions of this tensor product, which actually I won't go into here. It's just the key point here is that you have these mutual centralizers. So now let's go to the deformed setting. So UQG has a deformed representation. You can simply deform the vector representation, and you can do the same thing. You can define this n-fold representation of n-fold version of this representation pi q in terms of the deformed coproduct. And then what you have to do on the other side, you have to replace the group algebra of the symmetric group by the Hecke algebra, which I've given you here. So it's really just the relations as you're used to for the symmetric group, except I have this deformed relation, and you can clearly see as q goes to one, SL goes to an involution. So it's literally just becomes the ordinary simple transposition. And then the story is completely analogous. You can have this representation rho from the symmetric group. You can replace it by a representation rho q of the Hecke algebra, and it's simply this of the same structure that the SL, this generator, is acts by PR, where P is simply that simple flip again, and R is a particular matrix. You can kind of calculate it ad hoc, but it is actually given by the universal R matrix for UQGLN, sorry. Okay, and then the statement, and I think it was Jimbo who first found this. Maybe he did it for SLN, perhaps, but it's some kind of technicalities that you can go to SLN if you like, but then you have to replace the Hecke algebra by something else. But in this setup, you can have a precisely analogous statement about mutual centralizers for the quantum deformed setting as well. Okay, so it's a kind of an extension of standard or classical Schuwald duality. Okay. And then, of course, there's naturally some topology that appears here. So the Hecke algebra is a quotient of the Breidt group, let's say, of n points in a disk. So here's the disk, and here are my n points. And then you kind of let the time go in this direction, and these points trace out strands. And the Breidt group tells you what is possible in terms of how these strands interact without intersecting each other. And then you have a kind of canonical surjection to the Hecke algebra by simply saying that this picture here maps to the generator SL. And then the cubic relation that's part of the defining relations of the Hecke algebra corresponds to this standard Breidt picture. Okay, and so that's in the same way the class of modules of the quantum group becomes a braided tensor category. It's to do with this topological point of view. Okay, so that's that essentially. But then I can ask a question. So we have this statement of mutual centralizers for UQG and this Hecke algebra. Can I replace the Hecke algebra by something larger? So let me call it HBQN, where B for now just stands for bigger, and preserve this duality. So I want to have a representation rho BQ, which is an extension of the original representation rho Q, and it acts on the same space. I'm not going to a bigger tensor product. I'm staying in the same tensor product. And then what you need to make this picture fit is to have a subalgebra of UQG in order to keep the statement of mutual centralization, right? Because you're replacing something, you're going bigger here, you have to go smaller here in order to keep this statement of mutual centralizers. And let me then straight away assume that UQ is this subalgebra is actually the UQ of something in the Lie algebra. So I can take a Q to one limit if I want to. And well, this is the question, are there nice examples of this? Okay, well, so the letter B secretly stood for type B, not just for bigger. So you can easily adjoin a generator to the Hecke algebra to get the Hecke algebra of type B. The original one is type A. And that means you're adding a generator that satisfies a quartic relation with one of the generators and commutes with the others, and then also satisfies some polynomial identity, which I don't specify here. I want to leave that kind of unspecified, but it could be the same. It could be some kind of quadratic relation, for instance. And now, what is the natural way to extend the representation? Well, if you want to keep this statement of commutativity, it's then convenient, considering where the SL acts non-trivially, to put to require that this S0 acts only trivially in the first tensor leg by some linear map K, matrix K, which then has to satisfy this quartic relation to match this. And in order to have at least a chance of mutual centralization, it should at least commute with the action of UQK. Okay, so you need to compose this, okay? So, okay, that would be kind of an interesting picture. So, and then clearly, it stands to reason that there's different choices you could make. So I could make a different choice for UQK. I could make it larger or smaller subalgebra of UQG, and that would influence the choice of this matrix K. Okay, so one trivial choice, if you like, is simply to let UQK be the whole UQG, and then K would be the identity matrix. It's kind of an extreme situation. But there are more possibilities in general. In fact, if I replace G by an arbitrary simple Lie algebra, then the UQG will have several interesting, at least one interesting subalgebra in addition to this trivial case. Okay. And then this condition here, to kind of verify this in practice, is a bit of hard work because I have to do it for all n. So it would be nice if I could only do it for n is one, the statement, this statement here for n is one simply becomes this. Okay, and so, and the question is, when does this, is this simple statement enough to reproduce all the other statements for arbitrary n? And that's precisely, well, a natural condition for this is when UQK is a right co-ideal, which means that when I take the co-product and apply it to an element of UQK, I get a linear combination of elements in UQK, tensor elements in UQG. Okay, that's a natural condition to impose here in order to have this equivalence and kind of make the picture nicer. Okay. So what is the topological story here? So you add now, so you have this disk again with the n points, and now you also have a puncture. And now when the time evolves, if you like, the points may go around this puncture. And this is captured by the special new generator S0. And you can already see, if you kind of squeeze your eyes, that looks a little bit like a capital K, that picture. So that's why we call this the K matrix. And sometimes life is kind of simple, and you know, you can make this choice of symbol. And so this quartic relation, this type B Braid relation, is simply then this topological identity, which you can kind of stare at for a few seconds and convince yourself it's true. So that's basically the topological setting of this. So it's the Artin Braid group of type B. Okay, so now the question becomes, can we find a subalgebra of UQG that provides us with this construction? So now I was talking about GLN. So now let me go back to this story, the setting of simple Lie algebras to make life a little bit easier. So let's say we have a simple Lie algebra over the complex numbers, finite dimensional. We know them very well. They have nice representation theory. And suppose I have a fixed point subalgebra of an involutive Lie algebra automorphism theta. So I call subalgebra, I call it K, just as in the duality story. And then Letzter discovered that if you write theta in so-called Sartaki form, which is basically a particular way of writing any Lie algebra automorphism, but for involutive ones you can do this in such a way that the intersection of the fixed points of algebra with the Cartan is minimal, then there's a nice quantization of UQK of K called UQK, and it's a right co-ideal. So this is what we are after. So not necessarily a bisubalgebra, but a co-ideal, which is enough to kind of have this story of Schurwald duality, at least to make that story feasible. So the intuition for having a minimal intersection with the Cartan is that in the end I want to construct intertwiners for this subalgebra K. And in for representations where H acts diagonally. So if the intersection is too big, the intertwiner will be too diagonal, and in some cases it will simply be just the identity matrix, and that will be too restrictive. So it's better to work with a smaller intersection where you get more interesting intertwiners. That's roughly a very, very kind of hand-wavy argument for why you want this condition on the intersection. But anyway, so the Sartaki picture, the Sartaki form of these automorphisms gives you this. I should maybe say that a few years before Letzter, Noumi, Sugitani, and Dijkhuizen actually constructed the same co-ideals in a different way, not using a Sartaki description. And Letzter was not aware of this, but this was actually really good. If she had been aware of this, she might not have done this work, which was kind of a lot of theory development from scratch for quantizations of these Sartaki improtive automorphisms. So it kind of worked out nicely for the development of the theory. And then more recently, we're actually taking such a right co-ideal subalgebra, quantum symmetric pair subalgebra, Balagowicz and Kolb found explicitly constructed the desired element K, following earlier work by von Bau and Wang in a particular case, roughly corresponding to the GLN picture I showed you earlier. Sorry. So the explicit is an explicit construction. We'll go into the detail soon, but basically it is an element K such that conjugation by K restricts to the identity when you are talking about when you're sticking to the subalgebra, which simply means that K times U is U times K. So of course, if U is in UQK. And then this co-product formula is produced for this element K. And then as a consequence of this co-product formula, you immediately get this type B2 braid relation out of it. And it's a simple consequence of the fact that R intertwines the co-product with the opposite co-product. Okay, but this is actually not quite what's going on. And it's actually interesting to identify what is actually the picture they do prove. And it's a small modification. Instead of the identity on the right here, let me quickly modify this here. Instead of the identity, what's really going on is that it's some bi-algebra automorphism, let's say psi, restricted to UQK. Now, the quantum group doesn't have very many bi-algebra automorphisms, but there are a few, and they're essentially diagram automorphisms of the underlying Dinkin diagram. But that's really the construction they do. And this R here becomes R psi, and where R psi is simply psi tensor 8. Okay, so this is really the construction that's going on. And then the braid relation gets twisted by psi in that same way, where these R's are actually R psi. Okay, this is not a problem, but it's actually it gave us a hint of how to generalize this. So it's good to point it out here. But you can think of psi being the identity for simplicity, if you really want the braid relation to come out in its cleanest form. And in many cases, it is the identity. So because we're working with a completion, so this K lives in the completion of UQG. This is the one tensor-like completion of UQG. It acts on objects of finite dimensional, on certain finite dimensional, I should say, modules in UQG, namely those ones where the cartons act by powers of Q. So applying a map, a representation pi Q, such a finite dimensional representation pi Q gives you a made object capital K, and that satisfies the kind of the basic requirements for a boundary Q sure well developed. Okay, so that's kind of the what comes out of this construction, one of the things that comes out of this. Okay, so what do we want to do? So we want to replace this finite dimensional subalgebra algebra G by a Kac-Moody Lie algebra. So these finite dimensional simple Lie algebras have a Chevalier-Serre presentation, and you can easily modify this and generalize this to a weaker setting where the Cartan matrix is replaced by a generalized Cartan matrix. And if that Cartan matrix is symmetrizable, which is kind of a very condition on the entries of the matrix, which is easily checked, then you have a Kac-Moody algebra with a symmetric bilinear form, and you can consider the quantum group version of this as well. And then we need to have some kind of subalgebra, and then basically the same story holds. You can have an involutive automorphism, but now this has to be of the second kind, which basically means that up to a finite dimensional exception, the two nilpotent subalgebras must be interchanged. So in other words, the intersection of n of the nilpotent the upper nilpotent subalgebra with its image under theta must be finite dimensional. That notion was studied in the late 80s, early 90s, and these objects are well understood, these automorphisms. And you could rephrase this in terms of the language we've used so far, is that these are precisely the involutive automorphisms with a Satake form. So in the infinite type setting, not all involutive automorphisms have a Satake form, and it's precisely the ones of the second kind that do have this and do allow for the fixed point subalgebra to be quantized to a co-ideal in a uniform, in a pleasant way. And this was done by Stefan Kolb. 8 years ago, he found this Rightgo ideal, generalizing Ledster's work. And so our goal is really to construct a universal K-matrix for a good category of modules for the Kac-Moody, of the quantum version of the Kac-Moody algebra. And so this is the category of integrable modules in category O. If you know what category O is, then you're almost there. And basically it's the particular type of modules there. And the plus is simply a little addition I'm introducing here. Because as we will see, there will be also an O int minus version naturally playing a role here. And it's important to distinguish the two. And this O int plus, if you talk about, if you restrict G to be a finite dimensional simple Lie algebra, it comes back to the normal finite dimensional representation. So we're really kind of generalizing in the right way. We're recovering, hopefully, if this all works out, we'll be recovering the results from Balagowicz and Kolb. Okay, and there's a second part of this question, which actually is the original problem I was trying to solve. If A is of affine type, which is one of these non-finite Kac-Moody types, then the corresponding Kac-Moody algebra is also called an affine Lie algebra, and it can be constructed in a different way, at least in the so-called untwisted affine setting, but the twisted one is similar, is you can take a finite dimensional simple Lie algebra, let's call it G-fin, and you can construct its loop algebra, which is basically this extension, this tensor product in terms of a formal parameter Z, describing loops around the origin. And then you extend this with a central extension and an extension by a derivation, and then you get precisely back the Kac-Moody Lie algebra defined in terms of a Cartan matrix of affine type. Okay, this subalgebra here, without this last extension, is the derived subalgebra. And this derived subalgebra has finite dimensional representations. The category O plus that we just discussed doesn't have non-trivial finite dimensional modules in it, except if G itself is a finite type. But for affine type, there's another way of getting finite dimensional modules by using this loop algebra construction. So simply, you can take a representation of your finite dimensional, in quotation marks, quantum group, and lift it to a Z-dependent representation of UQG prime, which is called an evaluation representation. And then you can, at least in a kind of formal way, evaluate a universal R matrix and get a parameter-dependent matrix, but generally a matrix, finite dimensional object, that satisfies what is called the Young-Baxter equation. This is the terminology from the physics literature, but it's basically a parameter-dependent version of the type A2 braid relation we already saw. Okay, and so this is very important for the application to physics, to have a parameter so you can construct a family of operators, roughly speaking, a generating function of conserved quantity. So you want to have this kind of extra bit of freedom there. And then the goal, the second goal, is to do the same thing for the reflection equation. So you have a parameter-dependent analog of the type V2 braid relation. And the idea is that hopefully if you have such a universal object, little k, to apply this representation pi z and get something sensible, at least a formal series perhaps. And then this should, hopefully, if that can be done, then we partially have this, satisfy this this parameter-dependent quartic relation. And this arose in the 80s from studies of integrable systems with boundaries. So remember the picture that we showed of this braid element, which was something like this. You can think of it as a particle bouncing off a boundary, roughly speaking. This is a very dodgy analogy in some sense, if you want to make it physically rigorous, actually, but it's good enough for the conceptualization, and it can be used in physics appropriately if you're careful about certain things. But I don't want to go into too much details. I just want to say here that actually many solutions are known, many matrix solutions of this reflection equation are known. But it's basically a big zoo of solutions, and most of the results are only for the vector representation, the affinized, quantized vector representation. And it would be good to have a framework that supports this big family of solutions. Okay, so that's the second goal. So in fact, this was the original goal, and we can answer goal one and not yet the original goal completely, although we have some good heuristics and some partial proofs and partial in special cases, whether it is true. Okay, so let's look at the quantum group in a bit more detail. So this is a fairly short section, and it might you might already have seen these results, but I will highlight some specificities of the Kac-Moody setting, as opposed to the finite dimensional setting. So you have this. So this is the most boring slide of the presentation. It's just a list of notation, unfortunately, but it's all fairly standard notation. So I'm just outlining here how you construct UQG using Lie theory. So you start with some combinatorial data, which in this case is initially a Dinkin diagram, and the nodes I will denote by the letter I. You have a Cartan matrix A, and we've already discussed the different types. You have finite, affine, or the rest, which is called indefinite. Then there's you create a vector space H, which is just in the end it ends up being your Cartan subalgebra of your Lie algebra, and then the Lie algebra is simply denoted by G as usual. Working over C, it's a Kac-Moody Lie algebra in terms of a presentation, so it's generators and relations. It's inspired by the Chevalier-Serre presentation of the finite dimensional semi-simple Lie algebras. And the generators I will denote by little e and little f. These are like the standard upper and lower nilpotent matrices, and then you have the Cartan sitting there, the H, the Cartan is sitting there as well. You have a triangular decomposition, and then so this is all as usual. It's just that's precisely why Kac-Moody algebras are interesting. They allow for this the well-known theory of semi-simple Lie algebras to be extended in a pain-free way. The only thing that's different here is that you have the Cartan is potentially larger than what you're used to. So if your Cartan matrix is not invertible, you have to add generators to make a certain bilinear form non-degenerate, which is what you want. And that's precisely these extra generators dr. And if it's an affine Cartan matrix, then the co-rank is one. So you just need one extra generator. And that's precisely the b that I mentioned in the previous slide about that gives us this extra extension to the from UQG prime to UQ, from G prime to G. Is extension by a derivation. So you can think of D in the loop algebra story as acting by ZDDZ. To get the quantum group, you have to have some lattice. So this is precisely why a quantum group is called a quantum group. It's in some sense quantized. So you have, rather than working with the whole vector space H, we work with a lattice, and there's some freedom, there's some different choices you can make, but I'm working with the so-called extended co-root lattice, which is simply the same generators again, but now the Z module generated by it. You choose a non-zero complex number Q, which you don't want to be a root of unity. And for a definition, you just don't want it to be one or minus one, but for the representation theory, you don't want it to be a root of unity. And then you can make analogous definitions. So UQH is the only one that's a little bit different because the generators, which I will call TH, will be invertible. They will basically be, roughly speaking, Q to the H. That's the moral here. So this UQH is really the group algebra of this lattice. That's really what this formula tells you here. And then you add analogous elements as before, upper and lower nilpotent elements, and you have a Chevalier-Serre type representation with Q deformed relations. And you have the same kind of subalgebras, and you have this triangular decomposition as well. So that's very similar. And now let's talk about these categories of representations. So let's look at the Z dual lattice to the co-root lattice in the dual of the Cartan, which is called the extended weight lattice, PX. And then what I'm interested in is a subcategory of all UQG modules, namely those which are finitely generated, have a nice weight decomposition. So the TH acts precisely as Q to the H. So you can write an analogous thing for the Kac-Moody Lie algebra, where it's just H acting by multiplication by lambda H, where lambda is a weight. And then the appropriate nilpotent subalgebra must act locally finitely. So depending on your choice of sign. So there's two choices. You can choose plus and minus, and you can make you must make the analogous choice here. That's the only difference in the definition, the only way where this choice of sign affects the definition. And then finally, this is the last condition, which is called also called integrability. E and I and FI must act locally and importantly. Okay, so this allows us to write down rate group generators that Lustig found that we can act with on modules, which will be important for the construction. But more importantly, at this stage, is the following nice set of properties. These two categories are semi-simple. They're tensor categories, so they're closed under taking tensor products. If you have finite type Cartan matrix, you just get the finite dimensional modules. If it's not finite type, then they're not the same. And in fact, their intersection is trivial. The intersection is just a trivial finite dimensional modules given by the action of the co-unit. And there are no other finite dimensional modules in this category. And this is kind of relating these two categories. There's a equivalence of braided tensor categories from O plus int to O minus int, but here you have to take the opposite tensor product. And you simply take a very simple algebra automorphism of UQG, which is a co-algebra anti-automorphism. That's why this op appears. And it's simply this map omega, which is a Q deformation of, in fact, a trivial Q deformation of the Chevalier involution, by which I mean the map that sends, so omega is really the map that sends a matrix to minus its transpose, which is a nice Lie algebra automorphism. Okay, and this is just the quantum group version of it. Okay, so the omega is an important player in this story. And then you can you can construct an R matrix. So let's quickly outline, roughly speaking, Lustig's approach to the R matrix. Lustig introduces an involution. It's not actually an involution here, because Q for me is not an indeterminate, but a complex number. So I'm going from UQG to UQ inverse G. These are two quasi-triangular bialgebras with the same Q to one limit. And I'm simply keeping the E's and the F's the same, and I'm replacing TH by T minus H. In other words, I'm sending Q to Q inverse on the level of the generator as well. And then there's a new co-product you can define, which is given by conjugation by this bar map. Okay, this bar isomorphism. And then, so why is this useful? Well, the universal R matrix naturally factorizes into two factors. There's an R tilde, which is called the quasi R matrix, which intertwines the usual coproduct with the barred coproduct. And then this extra factor kappa intertwines the barred coproduct with the opposite coproduct, which is what you want to get to with the R matrix in the end. Okay, so there's a intermediate stage which is useful to identify, and this is precisely what will happen with the K matrix story as well. There will be a natural factorization, and we can track precisely what happens with the how conjugation by the K matrix affects the subalgebra UQK. It's analogous to this setting, although it's slightly more complicated in some sense. But this is the takeaway message from here: is these two equations in red. Okay. Now, the new concepts that we found that allow us to generalize the construction by Balagowicz and Kolb in a more in the Kac-Moody setting. So let me first give you a kind of an old definition that Drinfeld gave. He considered the notion of twisting a bialgebra by an invertible element of the tensor product as follows. So you have an element J lying in this tensor product, and I'm requiring that J satisfies the so-called co-cycle identity, co-cycle property. It is a property in the threefold tensor product of H. So I've got these funny subscripts appearing again, telling you where this J acts non-trivially. And if you found such a J, then any scalar multiple of J will satisfy the same equation. So you want to have some kind of normalization condition, and that's given by this co-unit condition. Okay, but that's not a hugely important condition. It's the first one that's really important. What you can do is, and the following statement follows naturally, if you have a quasi-triangular bialgebra, you can have a new quasi-triangular bialgebra in the sense given by conjugating by this J. So the co-product becomes modified by conjugation by J, and the new R matrix is roughly speaking also conjugating by J, but to make it work you have to have J 2-1 here, and 2-1 simply means swapping the tensor legs of your made of your element J. Since it lives in the twofold tensor product, that makes sense. Okay. Now, some examples. So R itself, but the fact that R satisfies this threefold, this cubic relation, precisely implies this co-cycle condition. So R, or if you want R to one inverse, it's the same story, gives you a Drinfeld twist, and the corresponding modified quasi-triangular bi-algebra is simply the co-opposite bi-algebra. Okay, so that's one way of getting something new, but we've already seen that one, so it'd be nice if there's other Drinfeld twists. But it's actually really difficult in general to find a canonical Drinfeld twist. For UQG, we give many examples, but they require some kind of nitty-gritty detail. They exist, and we'll see them very soon. But so the R matrix itself is kind of a canonical example that works in any quasi-triangular bi-algebra. Okay. There's another way of twisting bi-algebras. That's simply by algebra automorphisms. So if I have a psi, an algebra automorphism, then I can simply conjugate by psi, and get a new bi-algebra structure, and I can also apply it to the R matrix. Like this, and I get a new R matrix. And because it's an algebra automorphism, this guarantees that the axioms of the quasi-triangular bi-algebra are satisfied, are preserved. Okay, and then it was useful for us to kind of package these two things together, these two types of twisting. So if you have a quasi-triangular bi-algebra, you have such an algebra automorphism and a Drinfeld twist, and you have a twist pair, provided they are compatible, these two ingredients. So the idea is that psi should be an isomorphism of quasi-triangular bi-algebras from the co-opposite bi-algebra to the J-twisted bi-algebra, where J is the Drinfeld twist. Okay, so that's psi is a way of going from these two kind of Drinfeld-twisted bi-algebras. So two examples. One is trivial but useful. To highlight, if psi is actually an automorphism of quasi-triangular bi-algebras, then this story here won't give anything new. So the twist pair will just have R21 and Rj on here. The psi's don't matter. And here the psi doesn't matter either. And then you know from the previous slide that you can take J as R or R21 inverse. Okay, so that's one twist pair. And one that works specifically for UQG is you can take this omega, this Chevalier involution, and take the trivial Drinfeld twist. That also works, and for the reason that omega goes from UQG to UQG co-op or vice versa, because it's an involution. Okay, so that precisely gives another twist pair. And the twist pairs we're actually be looking at will kind of be in between these two. These are kind of extreme situations. So we're gonna modify omega a little bit to get a new twist pair, is roughly the idea. But then of course this one tensor one needs to be modified as well. Okay, so here's the main definition that allows us to formalize the universal K-matrix in a more general setting. We have a quasi-triangular bi-algebra HR with a twist pair, psi J. And you have an element K that's going to be this special element that we call universal K-matrix. So you have this datum of these five ingredients, and we call it cylindrical. Cylindrical coming from this picture of the braid group. So there was this this puncture here. This was points on a disk. But if I let time evolve, then this becomes a thickened cylinder. So that's why we call it cylindrical. Actually, the terminology was already in existence. And we actually, in the paper, we call this almost cylindrical. But I think I can keep things simple. This is a generalization of something that's called cylindrical. But let's just call it cylindrical for simplicity. So now the co-product of this K won't have an R matrix, but J inverse here. More general setting, because the R matrix is a particular example of a Drinfeld twist. And here you have the R psi appearing. That's just the same as it was for Balagowicz and Kolb, where psi was bi-algebra automorphism. But here, in general, it can be an algebra automorphism. So you can kind of think of the twist pair as saying that psi fails to be a bi-algebra automorphism, but the failure is happening in a controlled way, which is controlled by a Drinfeld twist. This is kind of a way of thinking about it. And then a sub-algebra, let's say B, is cylindrically invariant. It's just a definition if conjugation by K restricted to B is simply this map psi restricted to B. And a word of warning here is that neither at K nor psi need to preserve B. So you might go out of B. But the point is that if you do at K, then with psi inverse, you can go back into B. Okay, so it's a kind of a more general setting, kind of a fairly general setting. This notion that psi does not have to preserve B also is applicable to the Balakiewicz-Kolb story where psi is a pi-algebra automorphism. It doesn't have to preserve this the coital subalgebra. Now, a special case is basically what I just briefly mentioned. If you set J equal to R to one inverse and say let psi be an automorphism of quasi-triangular bi-algebra, you have a twist pair, and the coproduct formula simplifies to the one I annotated in the section where we discussed the Balakiewicz-Kolb formalism. So you just get this coproduct back, and you get the old style quartic braid relation, where there's there's still this psi, but it's not too far off a normal clean braid group relation. So this recovers the formalism from Balakiewicz-Kolb, and also, so this is the case where psi is the identity. And this was done by Tom Deacon here in Oldenburg in the late 90s, where they all actually constructed a kind of quasi-universal element for a particular case. So you can see that Balakiewicz-Kolb also generalized their work by introducing this psi into the picture. Okay, so why do we care about cylindrical bi-algebras in this more general setting? Well, you still have a braid relation, but it's modified by psi. So the proof is really simple. It's essentially the same proof as I had for the case where psi was a bi-algebra automorphism. So simply you write down on the left-hand side, you recognize as the coproduct of K with some extra stuff. The extra stuff is given by R to 1 double psi J, but then you can use the twist pair property and you rewrite it like this. And now the R can go through the coproduct as R matrices do, and then you rewrite it in terms of the given formula for the coproduct, and you get this. And so you have another four-factor expression. Okay, so the only difference is really now that this R psi to one. If psi is a bi-algebra automorphism, a quasi-triangular bi-algebra automorphism that becomes R to one, and that gives you back the original picture. Okay, so why do we care about this particular modification? Why is that a good thing to try? So if it so happens, in the case of the affine quantum group, where we have these Z-dependent finite dimensional representations, if I can arrange things that this property holds true, where this map psi accomplishes inversion of this parameter, then goal two is reached automatically. I can simply take this relation on the top half of the screen and apply, let's say, pi z1 tensor pi z2, and I get the reflection equation that Cheretnik and Skiranin studied in the 80s. The question is, can I do this property here? Can I make this true for choosing psi suitably, by choosing pi psi suitably? And I can do it in many cases. I can give a heuristic idea that it should work, and I can prove it for, let's say, affine SL2 at least, or one particular example. So that's, at least it's kind of a motivation for trying this out, this type of construction. And then along the same lines, this first axiom, so the one that doesn't really impact the reflection equation yet, but it relates to this it relates K, the matrix K, to the coital subalgebra B, it implies by again simply applying the representation to this to that relation that you have an intertwining property of a matrix, a parameter dependent matrix, with the action of the coital subalgebra on your representation. And this was used separately to derive the Cheretnik-Skiranin reflection equation using an irreducibility argument. So if you can prove this intertwining equation, then you can also connect with the reflection equation. So we wanted to have this as well sitting there, and the same formalism, it's compatible with both polymorphism are compatible, provided you have this relation with the spectral parameter. So that's one argument. The second argument is that Chiratnik in 92, in a later paper, introduces generalized quartic braid relations, and the idea is that these are kind of the most general quartic braid relations that you could possibly want, but they have this parameter dependence still sitting inside them. But they seem to suggest some kind of map psi that goes from one type of representation to another. Let's say from a representation of UQN plus, or a representation where UQN plus acts nicely to a representation where UQN minus acts nicely. And so the idea is, the picture is that this is still very much kind of needs to be filled in with more details, that you have, rather than strands going around ribbons, you have, sorry, going around the puncture, you have a two-sided ribbon going around the puncture, changing sides as it goes around the puncture. So the one side is colored by an O plus nth module, and the other one is colored by an O minus nth module, let's say. Of course, then you're in a situation where you the before and after are not quite the same, so you want to have another puncture, so a second boundary, to go back to O plus int, to have in the end get an operator that acts on O plus int. But so that still kind of requires a bit more detail, but at least our axiomatics matches Cheretnik's axiomatics in that sense. So there's not much time left, so let me just briefly highlight a bit about the construction. So let me at least address this point of this conjugation principle that we can now see nicely appearing in the case of the K matrix as well. So that, you know, stepwise conjugating to produce the desired relation for K. So let me just for this slide, I'll just highlight that. I want to emphasize here that I'm starting with a subalgebra of UQG, which is the quantum symmetric pair subalgebra that Stefan Kolb wrote down precisely, and I'm constructing K by imposing this relation. And I will show you how this relation can be, how that relation comes to life. And then after that, you have to compute the co-product and show that it satisfies this factorized expression as well. But I'll leave that detail aside. So I really want to focus on this kind of conjugation principle. Okay, so the datum that is required to write this down is a so-called Satake diagram. I don't want to go into the details here, but basically it's a way to prescribe involutions of the second kind, Lie algebra involutions of the second kind, and we can quantize it. So first of all, I can have a type of Lustig braid group operator. So Lustig writes down braid group operators. This is Lustig's notation. He considers different varieties of them. There's four of them, but this is one of them. This is the one that we can use. So let me call it T tilde X. So I call it T tilde X because it talks nicely to the quasi R matrix, which I called R tilde. But it's actually nicer to work with a corrected version, a version that's corrected by a Cartan element. And that correction, which I call Tx tau, it depends on more data than just than the sub diagram X. That talks nicely to the R matrix, not the quasi R matrix, but the actual R matrix of the subalgebra UQGX. And the key property that we want of this is that it's acts very simply on UQGX like this. So the omega is this Chevalier involution, tau is the diagram automorphism that's part of this datum. Okay, that's the upshot from this setup. It's really the key thing that comes out of this, that this relation holds true. Okay, so this X and tau are certain combinatorial data that allows me to do this on a subalgebra UQGX. Now theta Q is then a Q deformed version of, let's say, a Lie algebra involution of the second kind. And you will see, because of this formalism, that it will fix UQGX pointwise at least. And then you can construct a subalgebra like this. So this is Kolb's construction, generalized by from Lester's work, but modified in presentation. In the presentation, we now use a different type of Lustig operator, and also a different type of Chevalier quantization. So you have basically taken a bunch of elements that are kind of like fixed points of theta q, but not quite. But the, in the q to one limit, they are fixed points. And then you add this u gx, and you also add just the right amount of Cartan elements, not too many. Okay, so this deforms the fixed, the universal enveloping algebra, the fixed point subalgebra. And it's a right coideal, which is also what we want. And it also satisfies this intersection criteria. That the intersection with the Cartan is not too big. It's just the ones that I intentionally added there. And so this whole setup is kind of, all this kind of combinatorial requirements is there to produce that condition here. This coideal subalgebra, it's not too many Cartan elements. Okay, so this is the factorization after you rework the construction by Lagrange and Kolb into this slightly different braid group elements. This is what comes out. And the two key players here are the quasi-K matrix K tilde, which plays the same role as the quasi-R matrix, but then for the coideal subalgebra. So in other words, conjugation by the K tilde should do something nice. And it, what it does here is that it produces the same action as a particular map F, like that you can define ad hoc, but in, it's a very nice map. Namely, it fixes this part of the coideal subalgebra and these special generators. I'm sending it to barred generators. That's Lustig's bar involution, but with the parameters slightly modified. Okay, so there's parameters appearing in these coideal subalgebras and in these generators, and I modify them in an evolutive way. And then finally, there's another factor here, gamma inverse, where gamma is simply the parameters gamma I x again, but packaged into a group-like element of the extension of the completion of the Cartan. And you can then show ad hoc by just computation that it satisfies this. Okay. Right. So let's those ingredients are covered, and these are just the other two are the Lustig actions of the Satake diagram and of the whole Dinkin diagram. And this is what you can't do in the non-finite case, because the whole Dinkin diagram gives rise to an infinite Weyl group, which doesn't have a longest element. So this is the kind of the problem that you're faced with, how to replace it. Okay, anyway. This is just to show you how things now work nicely in terms of recovering the criteria that this element K should be intertwining the coideal subalgebra up to this correction factor psi. So it's very simple now. So you simply write down the definition of K. It's just, I mean, it's kind of intricate, but it all works nicely. You have these four factors. We know what at K tilde does. It produces this F on the coideal. And then we know what this factor gamma does. It produces the theta. And then recalling the definition of theta q in terms of the kind of constituent parts, you can simplify this further, and then you're left with this, and that comes out as that, as a diagram automorphism, in other words, as a bi-algebra automorphism of the quantum group, and this is the map psi that Balagowicz and Kolb find. Okay. Now, we can't quite do this here. The only thing that we need to change is simply this factor here. We need to change it. And then how do you change it? What is the right analog? Well, it's not clear what to do. You just write down something else. You write down some other factor for some other Satake datum. Okay, and this is, you have a whole family of K matrices now, and you write down what they satisfy, and you get some kind of reflection equation out of this. So that works fine. But now you work with a non-trivial twist pair. So you have a new psi, the psi that comes out of this, still has this diagram automorphism, but now another kind of quantized involution appearing, which is not a bi-algebra automorphism. And then the Drinfeld twist that you have with this is this R matrix for subdiagram Y, for this new subdiagram that I just kind of introduced here as kind of a new degree of freedom. And it's introduced, as well, it's defined in terms of these Lustig actions, these modified Lustig actions. So there's a twist pair, and then you have the theorem is that simply this setup, this twist pair, and this K K-matrix, you have a cylindrical biallgebra. In other words, K is a universal K-matrix, and UQK is cylindrically invariant. So that means it commutes with this element K up to this psi. Okay, and then this is the last thing I'll say because I've gone out of time. There's three natural choices for this extra datum. You can choose Y empty and eta to be the identity. That gives you a very simple answer. Then you just get, what you then get is essentially the quasi-K matrix. And that's quite a nice case because now if you send Q to one, what you get is an element of UG which centralizes the fixed points of algebra. You can also, just to highlight what happened in the work by Balagovic and Kolpe, simply this choice, we've already seen that. This can be done for A of finite type. And so then you revert to that picture. And then another special choice is if you take A of affine type, so this is the one I was particularly interested in, and you choose Y as big as possible, but still a finite type. So you remove one node, zero, the zero extra affine node, zero. And maybe if Tor doesn't stabilize zero, you add its image as well. You remove that Tor orbit from Y, and you choose eta kind of compatibly with that. That is the choice that seems to work, that produces its desired inversion behavior of the parameter. And that we can prove this for affine, quantum affine SL2 at least. And it's, and again, there's heuristics that it's true in general. Okay, there's some further generalizations which I just leave here. And then this is the reference. And so I just want to say thank you very much for listening. I'm sorry for going over time.
Okay, well, thank you very much for a very impressive talk. So we open, are there questions from anybody?
I have a quick, possibly stupid question. So when you normally have a quantized enveloping algebra, you can look at the dual and you have this compact quantum group.
Mm-hmm.
What does this give you on the dual side of things, if that makes sense?
Yes, that's a very good question, actually. And it's not known in the most general terms. So the point is that these sub-algebras that I've defined can be defined in a very uniform way, one size fits all. And the dual side is a bit more difficult to make precise, but it has been done in special cases. There's actually, so roughly speaking, the construction by Noumi, Sugitani, and Dijkhuizen does this. And then this was later redone in some sense, or in a more general sense, by Stockmann and Cole.
Okay.
And you can make sense of this. So this is a very good point, actually. You can even go back further. So in the 80s, and the Leningrad group and Rinfeld and those people were working on this, they wrote down some examples. Once they realized the importance of the reflection equation, they wrote down, let's say for UQSL2, you can look at the dual picture easily. You can find kind of explicit formulas for the dual version of this UQK. So it exists. Yeah, it's a good point.
Okay, I'll ask a question. So for these guys, for UQ over L, what do the Verman modules look like for an attribute twist?
Yes, that's a good point. So a Verman module, you always assume that, let's say, UQN plus acts trivially on a basic factor, the right? So that's how you set up, and then you act with UQN minus to generate the module. So you have to be careful here. So this is so the point is that these generators BI, these mixed generators that are that I wrote down explicitly, in general they don't have a it's difficult, I should say, it's difficult to see what happens with the action of the choroidal subalgebra on such modules. This is a really kind of important question. But the map psi, so what does the map psi do? The map psi interchanges, roughly speaking, interchanges UQN plus and UQN minus. So what it does really is the map psi is some kind of, at least the pullback of the map psi is a morphism from, we can just go back to what we said about omega, because omega is really the key example of psi. So it moves O plus int to O minus int. Yeah, so here, this statement that omega gives this braided tensor equivalence, you should be able to replace omega by any psi that I've indicated how you construct. So you still have this braided tensor equivalence. The point is that psi is like omega except for a finite dimensional correction. And so this this finite dimensional correction is like a finite dimensional quantum group. And so it acts like, and then this ferromodule, it will be acted upon like as if it were a finite dimensional module. So that won't cause issues, basically. So the map psi should be well defined for ferromodules, yes. And so ferromodules can be used to, in fact, describe this category Owens, as you can do for normal Lie algebras.
Yeah.
Okay. You can recover the finite dimensional representation from the ferromodule, and you can do the same for this setting here, where it's both quantized and infinite dimensional Lie algebra underlying it.
Okay.
You don't get finite dimensional modules out of it, but some other modules, which are these integrable O plus modules.
Okay, thank you. So are there any other questions?
Yep. Do you know what happens when we consider Q is a prime root of unity? So for these small Lustig quantum groups.
Yeah, so that's a very good question. So of course, for the quantum group, this has been well researched, and I simply have no intuition. Well, I mean, there's so many varieties of these colloidal subalgebras. I don't have any intuition. So I should really look at an example and try to understand that. But because of this work can be done in such generality, it's very tempting just to do the general work first, but to start something from scratch, this is a very good question. It's a very interesting question. So you can even make connections with modular Lie algebras then?
Yes.
And their subalgebras? But yeah, I don't know. It's a good question. Somebody should look at this.
Yeah, interesting. Because I was keeping this modular stuff as a background.
That's a very good question.
Okay, thanks. And maybe another question, but could you make some Dirac business with these guys? Your relative K.
So what?
Some Dirac business, some relative Dirac based on it.
Relative Dirac.
Pardon?
Well, I didn't understand. Relative.
Some relative Dirac operators. Could you relate them?
Dirac operators. It's a good question. I don't know. I don't. I would need to think more about Dirac operators. The moral is that anything you can do for a Lie algebra, you should be able to do for a quantum group. So, and then again, anything you do also in some sense do for one of these fixed point subalgebras and their quantized version. So, but it just becomes a bit technical, and I would have to think about Dirac operators. But it could be very interesting. I don't know.
So maybe I would ask a related question then. So for the flag map poles or quantum flag map poles, in the twisted case, you have VGG, quantum VGG, introduced by Eckenberger and Kolb.
Mm-hmm.
How might that extend to this? This would be for the quantum flag map poles of a Hermitian symmetric type, the non-standard.
This is maybe a bit more problematic here because in finite type, you have this notion. So I talked about automorphisms of the second kind giving rise to these colloidal subalgebras, these quantum spherical pairs, and you have automorphisms of the first kind that give, essentially in some way are related to flag manifolds. At least you are looking at automorphisms which preserve a Borel subalgebra, right? And they coincide, at least up to conjugation, they coincide in finite type, but they don't coincide in affine or other indefinite type. So I don't have there's not a clear way how to approach this, I think. It's perhaps kind of ill-posed, although it would be good to kind of maybe look at these finite dimensional evaluation modules for affine quantum groups and use the technology for UQG of finite type and see what, at least there you have a finite dimensional representation, so you feel like you should be able to do more
Yeah.
Do the things you're used to with finite type. But I don't have intuition for this. It's really a completely different story in non-finite type. Mm-hmm. Set kind of, it splits up into two different stories, if you like.
Sure. Okay. So, are there any other questions? No? Okay. It appears to be the case. So we'll thank the speaker again.
Thank you.
And